Hello everybody, my name is Corey, and welcome back to my channel. If you're new here, I like to do music reaction videos. In the last video, we reacted to Chapel Roan's debut EP, School Nights. So if you're a fan of Chapel Roan and you haven't listened to that EP yet, you should go check it out because it's kinda crazy. But today, we're going to be reacting to an album that I've been putting off, and it's become impossible to avoid spoilers at this point. We're reacting to BRAT by Charli xcx. I am going to be reacting to the deluxe version of this album. However, the deluxe tracks will not be in this video. They will be available over on my Patreon, and then I'll be uploading them in a separate video on this channel later on. But for a little while, they'll only be available over on the Patreon. So I haven't really listened to Charli xcx before. I've heard, obviously, some standout tracks of hers, like Boom Clap, and of course she's been around here and there, and there's probably songs I've heard by her that I did not know were hers. I think the most iconic thing I know about her is that one interview where she was mistaken for Lorde and she just kind of rolled with it. I'm not sure if that interview was staged and she just like went along with it or if it was like a genuine mistake on the interviewer's part, but it did make its rounds online and it was hilarious. So I've probably heard two or three songs off the album. I have seen 360, I've seen Von Dutch, and I think that's all the songs I've seen on Spotify. Maybe those were the two singles, I'm not completely sure. If you have any interesting facts about Charli xcx, please feel free to leave them in the comment section below. I always love learning about new artists, and obviously she's not like a new artist. I know of her existence. This is going to be the first project I actually listen to, start to finish, so I'm excited to get into this. I'm going to go ahead and click play on the first song of the album, 360. Like the way she says, I can't relate, you know, just so that you know she has an accent. So far, we're about 20 seconds in or something like that, and I'm getting the vibes. This is gonna be a dance album. This is like electronic, it's sort of like clubby a little bit. It sounds like a style of pop music that I've kind of been missing. Back in the day, we used to listen to a lot of like Iconopop and the Victorias, and I just feel like this is very reminiscent of that so far, except a little more modern sounding. Drop down, yeah. Bumping that beat. Bumping that meme makes more sense to me now. Wait a second. That city sewer sluts the vibe. Like the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles? Is that what we're talking about? Internationally recognized. I set the tone, it's my design. That city sewer sluts the vibe. Is she talking about herself here? So this is a fun song. Lyrically, wow. I don't know who Gabriette is. I don't know who Julia is. I'm basically a dumb baby. So there's that. Baby T is all gone. Drop down, yeah, looking like an icon. Work angles, yeah, 360. So is it like a photo shoot? When you're in the mirror, do you like what you see? When you're in the mirror, you're just looking at me. 666 with a princess streak. Okay. I like that part. Bumping that. Bumping that. I set the tone, it's my design, and it's stuck in your mind. Ooh, my. You gon' jump if AG made it, if you love it, if you hate it. AG. So stylish, baby T is all gone. Drop down, yeah, looking like an icon. Work angles. Yeah, 360, when you're in the mirror, do you know what you see? The synths in the background are so fun. There's like a little clap in the background too. Bumping that. Bumping that. Okay, strong opening track, honestly. It's such a vibe, it's very dancey, it's fun, and it kind of sets the album up to be an enjoyable experience. Something that's a little more upbeat, and there's just a level of this like electronic sound, but it's also a simple like electronic sound. It's not overproduced. One thing that always bugs me when I'm listening to music is when there's so much going on that you can't focus on the tune or the beat or the words. Nothing in that opening track seems to be like distracting any other parts of the song. Like, it all works together, it's all cohesive. The next track on this album is called Club Classics. When I go to the club, I wanna hear this club classics. Period. Oh, that sound. Wait, I like that. Oh, Sophie. Oh, that's cool. Oh, that's clean. Oh, this is so cool. Okay. Whoa. Ooh, the sounds in this song are crazy. Oh my god. Ooh, her voice. God, it's so cool sounding. Who produced this? Oh my god. Wait, Charlie's real name is Charlotte? How do you say her last name? Alchison? Wow. I'm left a little speechless. The production is so good. The sounds are so incredible. The words, like, obviously the words are not like that deep or meaningful, but this is a dance bop. It's talking about club classics. She says, when I go to the club, I want to hear those club classics. And then she lists off AG. Okay, I'm gonna have to hold on. I'm gonna have to look this up. I know Sophie. AG Cook is an English DJ and a music producer and a close collaborator and friend of Charli xcx. With his label PC Music, Cook is credited with creating some of the earliest examples of hyperpop and bubblegum bass. Cook has produced a great deal of Charli's songs. Some notable examples include Gone, Unlock It, and Next Level Charli, all of which I have not heard. Oh, and there's a little picture of them. When she says George, she's talking about George Daniel, a British drummer and record producer. He came to prominence as a founding member, principal producer, and drummer of the indie pop band The 1975. I don't know anything about that band other than Matty Healy's an awful person and he's the dickhead situationship that Taylor Swift was in. He's Charli's fiancé and has also worked with her as a producer on tracks such as Hot Girl, Bodies, 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 and In the City. Obviously, we know who she's talking about when she says Sophie, but for those of you who might not know, Sophie was a Scottish producer, close collaborator, and friend of Charli xcx. She produced some of Charli's most well-known songs, such as Vroom Vroom, No Angel, and Girls Night Out. On January 30th, 2021, she passed away after an accidental fall in Athens, Greece. It was very sad. When she talks about HUDMO, that stands for Hudson Mohawk, a Scottish-born electronic producer and DJ known for his left-field EDM work. Being also known for his collaborations with Tonight, he successfully culminated sounds of future garage, dubstep, and dance music together that brought a novel foundation to EDM-styled trap music in the early 2000s. Interestingly, Hudmo's song Seabat went viral and had a resurgent 11 years after its original release by virtue of a Reddit thread in 2022, wherein someone detailed playing the song during sex with their partner. The meme and song went viral on TikTok. As a result, many people heard Hudmo's work for the first time. Though during the rollout of Brat, Hudmo was confirmed to be a key producer on the album, and while appearing on BBC Radio 1, Charli herself talked about the exciting crossover. It's clear he's capable of producing club classics, Charlie would want to dance to. The last name that she referenced in this verse was tight like Mike kind of flow, so Mike. Charli clarified on a 360 Brat Instagram story that the lyric references English rap icon Mike Skinner of the streets. Charli posted multiple photos of Skinner to her story after clearing up the confusion surrounding the lyric. Okay, so that was Club Classics. I think all in all, that's a song you can bop to. And I think that's what she was talking about. She wants more Club Classics. It's the type of sound that if you were in the club and you were about four or five shots in and you were sweaty on the dance floor, you wouldn't even think twice about dancing. I'm really hoping the rest of the album is like this. Now, the next track on the album is one that I've seen Twitter talking about a whole lot. It's called Sympathy is a Knife. It's track number 3 on the album. And I have no idea what to expect from this. So I guess let's just click play. Okay, whoa. Relatable. That was good. Ooh. Oh my god. I just have to stop. This is like so fucking relatable. Let's look at these lyrics. I don't want to share the space. I don't want to force a smile. This one girl taps my insecurities. Don't know if it's real or I'm spiraling. One voice tells me that they laugh. George says I'm just paranoid. Says he just don't see it. He's so naive. I'm embarrassed to have it, but need the sympathy. Cause I couldn't even be her if I tried. I'm opposite. I'm on the other side. I feel all these feelings I can't control. Like, that's just so relatable. This is like a bipolar anthem right now. I feel all these feelings I can't control, like, hello. Me too, girl. Don't know why. All this sympathy is just a knife. Why I can't even grit my teeth and lie. I feel all these feelings I can't control. That sound in the background is so cool. Ooh, what is that? That like high-pitched like vocal? Ooh, that was cool. Wait. Na-na-na-na-na! Ooh, that's really cool. Damn, Charli, pop off. Wow. So it seems like that song is about insecurities, comparing herself to another person. It's kind of reminds me a little bit of Wildflower off of Billie Eilish's Hit Me Hard and Soft album, where she's talking about, like, she couldn't be more opposite of me, you know, wild and free and leather. Whereas Charlie's just, like, saying, like, I have these paranoid feelings about this person. We're not alike at all. She kind of makes me feel insecure, jealous in a bit. George says I'm paranoid. I think this is the George we heard about in Club Classics. He just doesn't know. He's so naive. Like, these are thoughts I've personally had about other people, just like projecting my insecurities and being paranoid about everyone's opinion of me. Even in like the workplace, I'm like, oh, everybody hates me. I can't live up to anyone's standards. And everyone's like, dude, chill out. You're just like overthinking things. I'm like, no. I'm pretty sure you're just lying to me or stupid. I really like this outro. Yeah, I really liked the vocal, like the modulation on her voice there. I was talking to my friend Michael, who has listened to this album a lot. And I was like, I don't know if I could handle if it's the same sound all the way through with the like vocoder sound effect. And he's like, I think she puts it in spots where it actually like makes sense and complements the song. And so far, I agree. Ugh, God, I just went on the genius blurbs. Some fans and media outlets theorize this song is inspired by Taylor Swift. Why is it always Taylor? Can you guys just like have anything and not talk about Taylor? Like, why does this Charli xcx album have to have anything to do with Taylor? Hey y'all, future Corey here. I'm editing this video and I'm realizing that I'm kind of a clown. I'm like looking at the lyrics while I'm editing it and I'm thinking about like, George is her fiance, right? And he's the drummer for the band The 1975. At this point, even though I knew he was her fiance, I guess I hadn't really put that together. And when she said that, like, I don't want her at my boyfriend's show, like, backstage, I hope they break up soon. Like, obviously, like, Taylor's not dating her man, but she was dating Matty Healy. And, like, God, I hope they break up soon. Like, this definitely could have been Taylor. I see where it's coming from. I just wish we could just stop talking about Taylor. Like, I love her, but why does she always have to be brought up when it comes to other people's music? I don't know, but I can totally see where, because I relate to Charlie's mindset in this song a lot, I could totally see where Charlie feels like a little bitter about it, because obviously this is when Taylor was like blowing up. And there's also a line about like thinking everyone is laughing at her and like they hate her. And when you're in a state of mind where you're feeling insecure and there are people around you that are more successful than you and they're like laughing and you don't feel like you're in that conversation or a part of the joke, it is so normal to think that you're the butt of the joke, to think, oh, they must be laughing at me. So I can totally see a situation where they're all backstage and she's with George and maybe there's a group of them over off in the corner and there's Maddie and Taylor and then they like look over at her and they're like laughing for a second and she could like misinterpret that, right? So anyway, this could be all like made up in my mind, but the pieces are fitting together and I'm understanding what the fans are theorizing about. I think until someone says verbatim, this is what happened, we don't know the truth. That's that on that. Just here to say that I get it. I see it. Kinda. Whatever.
I don't get it.
Some fans and media outlets theorize the song is inspired by Taylor Swift because of her lines in the second verse that describe her connection to Charli, and Charli tweeting the song name the day Taylor's album, The Torture Poets Department, was released. In this context, Charli is comparing herself to Taylor. The comparison seems a bit silly, but Charli hints at reasons why Taylor might trigger her insecurities in other confessional lines on Brat. I'm not going to keep reading this because it's very long, and I think it's going to spoil other tracks. The phrase, sympathy is a knife, is alluding to sympathy hurting Charli deeply. Receiving sympathy doesn't make Charli feel comforted, but instead makes her feel like it's disingenuous. It's just a lie. I feel so fucking called out right now. I honestly feel like 90% of the time, the things people say to me are disingenuous, whether it's a compliment or someone trying to be sympathetic or even empathetic. I feel like no one's actually really interested in the way I'm feeling. They're just doing what's polite, and that hurts.
Oh, God. Wow.
Oh, God, I wasn't expecting that type of song to feel like this, but here we are. So the next song on this album is track number 4, and it's a very, very, very relatable song title. I might say something stupid. Going into this album, I had a feeling it was going to be very boppy, dancey, clubby, and it was just going to be like, you know, mindless bangers. But so far, 4 songs in, it seems like a little bit of that, but also kind of diaristic. A little bit talking about insecurities and feelings she has, and I guess I wasn't expecting that. Kind of cool to relate to this music, if I'm being honest. So this is track number 4, I Might Say Something Stupid. Oh. I might say something stupid. Okay, I'm trying not to pause too often, but this sounds so freaking cool. The production on this album so far has been so top-notch. It has this like electronic drop sound. Like, does that make sense? It's like if you put an electronic filter on a water drop, like sound effect from an anime or something, and then it has this kind of synthy sort of dissonant chord. It just, in the first couple seconds, this is such an interesting song. Oh yeah. I might say
these clothes as disguise, just to re-enter the party. Door is open, let in but still outside. I look perfect for the background. I get nervous, sip the wine. I go so cold.
Oh, that's so pretty.
I go so cold, 'cause I don't.
That was very, very rude of you. Why? Just why? I might say something stupid, talk to myself in the mirror, wear these clothes as disguise, just to re-enter the party. Door is open, let in but still outside. That is, oh my god. I look perfect for the background. I get nervous, sip the wine. I go so cold, because I don't know if I belong here anymore. Jesus fucking Christ. The dissociation that you have to feel in moments where you, like, it just hits you out of the blue. You could be surrounded by people and just feel so isolated from everything going on around you. Oh god. What the fuck? This song represents the duality of Charli's philosophy behind Brat, that although Brat reflects a confrontational and bitchy persona, you can also be a brat when you are feeling vulnerable or self-conscious. The self-conscious side of being a brat could be reflected in this song, where Charli feels out of place, or as if she doesn't belong at a house party. Instead of talking specifically about parties, this line could also serve as a rumination on her evolving role within the music industry. What she expresses here is reminiscent of moments on other tracks where she questions her belongingness. Okay, so the next track on this album is track number 5. It's called Talk Talk. Saying that word out loud feels weird. Talk. Talk. You want to talk about it? Let's talk about it. I was talking to her the other day. Talk talk. Talk talk. Talk talk.
I've been looking at you.
Ooh, a clap in the background.
Putting holes in your head.
Putting holes in your head.
We've been talking for months, but never in the same room.
Okay, talking online.
Now I wanna approach ya, but we've been keeping this a secret.
Ooh.
And you're surrounded by friends, and I'm just wondering what they know. I wish you'd talk, talk, wish you'd talk, talk, wish you'd talk, talk.
Okay. Okay, this is good.
Think you're getting closer, 'cause I've been getting nervous. Talk to me, talk to me.
Oh, that's cool.
Why are you thinking about me?
Ooh.
I followed you to the bathroom, but then I felt crazy.
Ooh.
And I'm just wondering what they know.
It's not necessarily a secret relationship, but a relationship that's been mostly through the phone, texting, FaceTiming probably, and it's sort of like, again, insecure. Like, I've done this before where I've been like, is that person thinking about me? Is it time to, like, go talk to them? Like, should we start, like, hanging out in person? Like, even with, like, friendships at work, not even, like, romantic anything or sexual tension, just friendships. Like, oh, we've been like nice to each other at work. Is it time to like maybe have a hangout session outside of work? Like go to a movie or something, or like grab a bite to eat, you know? It's probably not as big of a deal to the other person as you're making it out in your mind. But as an insecure girly, I totally get it. Like, you don't wanna move too fast or cross a boundary or embarrass yourself. You don't wanna be rejected, especially in front of all his friends. Like, come on. Like, come on, come to me, make the first move. Sometimes you've just got to take it into your own hands. Throw caution to the wind. Talk to me, talk to me. Talk to me in French, talk to me in Spanish, talk to me in your ear. French and Spanish? Simlish? Okay, that last bit was cool where it sort of like pulled the production back and it was like a little muted and then came back in just for like a small second. Right here. That's so cool, so cool. One thing I do know for certain that I am feeling so far about this album is that the songs end very abruptly. Doesn't seem like there's a proper outro. There's a little bit of one, but it feels like half an outro. Maybe it's just because I'm so used to more classic pop music where there might be like a little fade out or some instrumentals going on there. Maybe I just don't understand it, but it does feel like song's over, song's over. Song's over. It's very finite. I'm kind of getting used to artists doing transitions a lot and things kind of moving from one track to the next, and that's not happening a lot on this album, where I kind of wish it would. Oh yeah, earlier I said I didn't know who George was, but I just read that he was her fiancé. I'm so stupid. This song is about the very start of Charli's relationship to George Daniel, and one of the first times she met him in person. Here she explains that this song is about a very specific moment. They were at the NME Awards at different tables, and it was the first time that they were ever really in the same room after a period of texting each other. Charli explains that there was definitely a sense of unspoken attraction in this moment, which is also made clear through the song. Period. Okay, so that was Talk Talk. I'm noticing that I like the sound of the album. I think as I continue to get more familiar with it, I'll be able to differentiate the songs a little more. When I read the titles of the song, I can remember the differences. Maybe I have like some sort of processing issue in my head when I'm not reading the songs. In my head when I'm not reading the track titles, I'm not remembering what I heard. And I think the reason for that is that it is just the same type of music over and over so far. So far, my standouts have been Sympathy is a Knife and I Might Say Something Stupid. The next song on this album is called Von Dutch. I actually think I might have heard this song already because Spotify likes to autoplay a bunch of songs, and sometimes when I'm at the gym, I just play whatever Spotify wants me to hear. Yeah. So these tracks are kind of short. We're already almost halfway through the track, and I haven't even had time to stop and analyze anything. What I'm looking at here, it's okay to just admit that you're jealous of me. Yeah, I heard you talk about me. That's the word on the street. You're obsessing. Just confess it. Put your hands up. It's obvious I'm your number one. This seems like the absolute opposite of Sympathy is a Knife. Von Dutch seems like the yin to the yang. If Sympathy is a Knife is expressing insecurities that another person makes her feel, Von Dutch is the complete opposite in denial of that feeling. I like, maybe it's deeper, maybe this is from the other perspective, the other person from Sympathy is a Knife and their reaction to Charlie. I don't know. I don't think it's that deep, but I think this just expresses how people can feel so many different ranges of emotions about one particular topic. Like, one day I can look in the mirror and love the way I look. The next day I can look in the mirror and spiral because I think I'm the worst looking person to ever exist. So it seems very two sides of the same coin to me. And that's exciting. The like sliding notes in the background. Not sure I like this song. I like this part. Okay. I think the song is a little too repetitive for me to like it. Here we go. Okay. Proper little fade out there. I think if I have heard this song, I don't really remember it because it's kind of just like something that could play in the background and I literally would not pay attention to. I would just hear it as like a beat. I think Von Dutch, that was a single, right? This was a single off the album. I'm not sure about it. It's, so far, it's my least favorite track. The next track on the album, track number 7, seems to be pretty popular with people on Twitter. It's called Everything is Romantic. Ooh, that's pretty. Oh. Wait, the strings?
Bad tattoos on leather tan skin. Jesus Christ on a plastic what? Sign.
Okay, I thought we were going there for a second.
Falling in love again and again. Riding roads doing manual drive. Early nights in white sheets with lace curtains. Capri in the distance. Bad tattoos on leather tan skin.
Whoa.
Jesus Christ on a plastic sign. All in love again and again. Winding roads doing manual drive. Bad tattoos on leather tan skin. Jesus Christ on a plastic sign. All in love again and again. Winding roads doing manual drive. Early nights in white sheets with lace curtains. Capri in the distance. In a place that can make you change. All in love again and again. Early nights in white sheets with lace curtains. Capri in the distance. In a place that can make you change. All in love.
Ooh, the water. Whoa. That was cool. There is production going on in this track that is so cool. It sounded like a waterfall before it led into that like video game glitchy sound that she did to her voice. I want to go back and listen to that again. Ooh, so cool. Okay. Oh, so cool. So cool. It goes. No. Hold on. It goes. Choo. Like a laser gun. That's so cool. I want to go back. I think I could just play this part on a loop for like 10 minutes. Ooh, so good. Yeah.
Diamonds on the trees and on the ground. Sandals on the stirrups of the scooter. Neon orange drinks on the beach. Four generations make up a family. Early nights and white sheets with lace curtains. Pompeii in the distance. In a place that can make you change. Fall in love again and again. 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 I'm falling in love again and again.
Ooh, ooh. Hello, Cybertron. Oh my god, I love this part. Oh my god, the song's about to end. If this doesn't pay off, I'm gonna be so upset. Like, build it up, do something. Is it just gonna repeat this for the whole time? Okay. A little muffled, a little louder. Ooh, a beat. Like a bass beat. Fade it in, kind of fade it out. It sounds like rickety floorboards or something. That was weird. Or like rain on a roof, like on a tin roof or something. Everything Is Romantic had a lot of good production moments in it. I'm not sure how I feel about the last like 30 seconds of the song or whatever, just repeating itself over and over again. I love the like water sound effects in the background, the woodwind instruments in the front half of the intro. I loved the strings. Like, I think it was just a cool track overall. Not really anything negative to say about it, other than this album's really repetitive throughout the whole thing. Each track seems to repeat itself quite a bit, which is fine. It's just a little too much for me. Okay, the next track on the album is track number 8. It's called Rewind. Sometimes I just wanna rewind. Ooh, that was cool. Oh, that's cool. Ooh, the harmony. I'd go back in time to when I wasn't insecure, to when I didn't overanalyze my face shape. Oh, I'm gonna die. That was, oh my god. This sounds like it could be a sequel to 360. The production where they're doing the little rewindy bits is fun. I just wanna rewind. I'd go back in time to when I wasn't insecure, to when I didn't overanalyze my face shape. Bitch, when did I start caring so much about my physical appearance? And why does it seem like as time goes on, I just care more and more, and I can't stop picking at my face, looking at the angles of myself in, like I just obsess over it now, and I never used to do that. I used to be so much more confident. Nowadays I only eat at the good restaurants, but honestly I'm always thinking about my weight. Yep. I used to never feel embarrassed when I call out the paparazzi. Everyone else does it constantly. Ooh, that was good. The little phone beeping sounds for calling up the paparazzi. Rewind. Used to burn CDs full of songs I didn't know. Used to sit in my bedroom putting polish on my toes. Recently I've been thinking about a way simpler time. Sometimes I really think it would be cool to rewind. I used to never think about Billboard, but now I've started thinking again, wondering about whether I think I deserve commercial success. It's running through my mind. Sometimes I really think it would be cool to rewind. This is just so crazy. It's just so crazy to me how relatable this thought process is. Here's the truth of this. You look back on simpler times. You look back at times where you weren't so obsessive, you weren't so concerned with everything, but that's all a fallacy. You've made it up in your head. I remember being a freshman in high school and being so fucking concerned about my weight. And now I'm like looking back at myself as a freshman and thinking like, wow, he was kind of like a twink. Like, why was I so worried back then? Now I'm like comparing myself to who I was back then and thinking that like I had it simpler and I was happier. But no, I've always held these insecurities. I've always carried them with me. I honestly think nostalgia is just a trick of the mind. It's impossible to not care about your own image, your own success, about your own story, basically. Like, you live in your body, you live in your mind, and there is nothing, absolutely nothing wrong with feeling those thoughts, with thinking those things. That's so cool. Ooh, that was cool. Let's go, Nintendo. Ooh, this pity. Sometimes I just wanna rewind, wanna turn back time to a different time. Oh, sometimes I just wanna rewind. I just wanna rewind. I just wanna rewind. Press rewind. Yeah. Yeah, press rewind.
rewind.
I like that. I've talked to my friends about this countless times where I just feel like, and maybe it's the rise of social media, maybe it's like the fact that we have access to everything at all times, the need to disconnect and just go back in time to when things were simple, it's so real. I remember like having LimeWire, you know, or torrenting songs or albums, putting them on my iPod Classic because like I wasn't plugged in all the time. There was no, you know, music streaming back then. It sort of felt more personal. Everything wasn't so consumable. It's interesting to hear Charli straight up, without like any sort of like metaphor or beating around the bush about it, just saying like, I remember a time when I wasn't obsessed with charting, Billboard, gaining commercial success, and now it's like all I think about. Like I used to just literally sit on my bed and paint my toenails, and now I'm worried about my weight, going to fancy restaurants, and trying to become a pop sensation. So the next song on this album is called So I.
Always on my mind, every day, every night, you're stopping so bright. Why did I put you away? I was scared sometimes. You had a power like a lightning strike. When I'm on stage, sometimes I lie. Say that I love singing these songs you left behind. And I know you always said it's okay to cry. So I know I can cry, I can cry, so I cry.
As you should, because it is okay.
You're a hero and a human. Track words, don't I make excuses? You would say, come on, stay for dinner. I'd say, no, I'm fine.
Ooh, I like that vocal effect.
Why did I put you away? I was scared sometimes. You had a power like a lightning strike.
I'm having a thought about this song. I'm gonna go to Genius. I'm performing a new song tonight. I've never performed it before, so I'm sorry if I get it all wrong. This song is about a person who is really, really special to me, who is no longer with us. My heart is beating really fast. It's called So I. This lyric has a somewhat straightforward meaning, as it describes Sophie and her legacy as a star that is burning bright. I knew this was a fucking Sophie song. I knew of Sophie. Her music is incredible. I'm gonna have to re-listen to it because the last time I listened to it was years and years ago. But I did not realize that Sophie and Charli were so close. This song is just so sad. Like, I'm tearing up. It's just so fucking tragic when an artist like Sophie dies well before they should have. Oh my god, I'm gonna go back a little bit.
You had a power like a lightning strike. When I'm on stage, sometimes I lie. Say that I love singing these songs you left me.
Oh, and Sophie helped produce a lot of her music.
Guilty feelings keep me fractured. Got a phone call after Christmas. Didn't know how I should act. I watched you dance online. Your sounds, your words live. When I make songs, I remember things you suggest. Make it faster with you like this man. Maybe just a little bit. Always on my mind. Every day, every night, you're stopping so
I'm really never gonna beat the cries too much allegations. Okay, just knowing what that song is about and relating, because there have been people that have been so close to me in my life that have passed away, and some people who haven't even passed away, they're just dead to me, which is really dark to say when talking about a song like this, but it's the truth. One of the lines that really got me when I was listening to this song: when I'm on stage, sometimes I lie, say that I love singing these songs you left behind. There is a level of course you love their memory, of course you love the things they left you and the times you had together, but sometimes you just don't love the feeling of reliving it. And you can attach the resentment for how you feel about the person having been taken from you too soon. You can attach that resentment to the actual things that made you love the person. That's why you hear so often when people say, like, I'm mad at you for leaving me. I can't believe that you did this to me. It feels like a personal attack sometimes. And I just can't. Okay, I can't. This one hit a little too close for me. I don't know how often I'm gonna be able to listen to that track. That one hurt. So I'm gonna move on to the next track. Track number 10 on the album is called Girl, So Confusing. This track I've heard so much about that it's become sort of like a meme with me and my friends, where we'll just use it in conversation, like, girl, so confusing. I saw a clip of an interview she was in where she was talking to the people and she's like, should I reveal who it's about? I don't know, should I? Some people speculated it was about Lorde, and then Lorde was on the remix, and then everybody said, like, girl, let's fix it on the remix, you know? We'll be listening to that remix along with the deluxe tracks, but we're just going to actually, like, finish out the basic album today. So this is track number 10 on the album, Girl, So Confusing.
It's so confusing sometimes to be a girl. Girl, girl, girl. How do you feel being a girl?
Love the drum beat.
How do you feel being a girl?
What am I doing?
Yeah, I don't know if you like me. Sometimes I think you might hate me. Sometimes I think I might hate you. Maybe you just wanna be me. You always say let's go out, so we go eat at a restaurant. Sometimes it feels a bit awkward because we don't have much in common. People say we're alike, they say we've got the same hair. We talk about making music, but I don't know if it's honest.
Okay, hold on. I'm not gonna lie, I was sort of just vibing and I forgot to listen to the lyrics.
Can't tell if you wanna see me falling over and failing, and you can't tell what you're feeling. I think I know how you feel. It's so confusing sometimes.
People thought this was about Taylor.
Confusing sometimes to be your girl. Maybe we're so meant to be just you and me. Cause girl, it's so confusing sometimes to be a girl, 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 girl.
I like that, but girl, girl.
It's so confusing sometimes to be a girl, girl, girl.
I like that.
Girl, girl, girl.
Ooh, that little alien sliding note. Outro is a little longer, actually. So a lot of people thought it was Lorde, a lot of people thought it was Taylor Swift. Genius says that the lines are likely aimed at Lorde, whom Charli spoke about collaborating with before. In an Instagram story posted on her private account, Charli replied to a fan who asked about the possibility of a Lorde collaboration and explained that she's talked with her about writing a song together, but the talks never led to any actual songs being finalized. That would later be changed as Lorde joined Charli and addressed the song in the remix of Girl So Confusing. Apparently some people think this is about Marina from Marina and the Diamonds. Seemed to butt heads as Marina claimed that fruit looks familiar when Charli did a campaign for dry shampoo in 2016. I forgot about that. That fruit looks familiar. And then I heard somewhere that some random person claimed it was about them and, like, admitted it was. I don't even remember who that person was, but anyway, girl, that's confusing. Next. The next song on this album is track number 11. It's called Apple. Pretty cool intro. Okay, I like this one.
I just wanna drive to be a boy.
This part sounds freaky and cool. Wow. Oh. This might be a crazy reference and maybe no one will get it, but on the Nintendo 64, there's a video game called Killer Instinct Gold, and there's this thing that they do when they stop someone from performing a combo on you, where it goes, combo breaker! That sound is ingrained in my memory, and it kind of sounded like that to me for some reason. Yep. So Apple is not my favorite track on the album. It feels kind of like a filler track to me, if I'm being a little honest. I am gonna look up the blurbs on Genius to see if there's anything I'm missing. There is one set of lyrics that kind of stood out to me, and it's, I think the apple's rotten right to the core, from all the things passed down from all the apples coming before. Sort of playing off, apple doesn't fall far from the tree, like where you were raised, your environment. And I think like kind of rotten down to the core. Is she talking about herself? Is she talking about someone else? Charlie suggests that she sees similarities between herself and the person she's been observing closely. So in looking at them for so long, she has come to see herself reflected in them. The expression, the apple doesn't fall far from the tree, also refers to children being like their parents. The lyric, I guess the apple could turn yellow or green, means that although she's like her parents, she is her own person and gets to decide throughout life whether she wants to be yellow or green. I guess the airport part is about Charlie growing up near London's Stansted Airport in Essex. So she might be referencing her parents' house. If we interpret apple to be about Charlie's family relationships. The airport here seems to be an escape for Charlie from a stressful relationship situation. In each verse of the song, she leaves when things get bad, either to the airport or driving away. The video for Brat's lead single, Von Dutch, features Charlie being chased through an airport. Charlie described this song as being about her, at times, complicated relationship with her parents. Charlie wonders what traits have been passed down to her, including the ones her parents possess that she doesn't love. She's hoping that she doesn't have these awful negative traits that her parents had that she can't stand, and she just knows that it's very possible. Throughout the song, Charlie explains how she uses traveling as a means of therapy. She's constantly driving or heading to the airport, which can be interpreted literally, or maybe she's scared of conflicts and leaves situations where they get too serious, like a fight or flight. Going to the airport, she chooses the flight. After reading The Genius, I kind of want to re-listen to the song one more time. I've totally done that. Been upset and obsessing over something, and to avoid thinking about it, or maybe to relish in it, drove and drove and drove and just drove for an hour, 2 hours. It's a waste of gas, but it's good therapy. The next track on this album is B2B. As far as I'm aware, that means back to back. Yeah, so Genius says the first lyric is literally back to back to back to back. So let's go ahead and hit play. Ooh, that sounds cool. Ooh, what's that sound in the background? Almost sounds like a tornado alarm. Like a siren. It's making me feel a little uncomfortable. This is a really weird song. The tempo, the sound, the repetitiveness. Working out, getting that pump tonight. Cool.
Yeah, muscles.
I wish my muscles looked better. I don't even know how to flex. Oh, look at that.
What am I doing?
Ooh. You know I love a song that involves heavy breathing, the however, this song is a skip. I don't even think I need to think about it. There's two interesting moments. Production changes for the first time when she stops saying back to back to back to back and she just starts saying back, 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 back. And then there's also the like sliding alien sounding notes with the like tornado siren alarm sound. That's the most interesting part of the song. Lyrically, I'm not interested. I'm actually kind of like super not into the song. The song to me is, you know what? I'll listen to it one more time, maybe two more times in the future, not right now. But back to back. Okay, the next track on the album is track number 13. It's called Mean Girls.
Yeah, it's 2 a.m. and she's out there in a sheer white dress, wearing last night's makeup, all coquettish in the pictures with the flash on.
Ooh, wait. Coquettish. Hold on. Let me Google that word because that's a new word. Describes a woman's flirtatious manner. If you were acting in a coquettish way, you might banter playfully and bat your eyelashes. Coquettish is the adjective form of the noun coquette, a young, flirtatious woman.
In a sheer white dress, wearing last night's makeup, all coquettish in the pictures with the flash on, worships Lana Del Rey in her AirPods.
So many people dropping the name Lana Del Rey lately. Hedonistic with the gravel drawl and dead eyes. Whoa.
You say she's anorexic and you heard she likes some people say it. Think you already know it, but you
Okay. Why am I having such a hard time keeping up with this one? Yeah, she's in her mid-20s, real intelligent, hedonistic with the gravel drawl and dead eyes. You say she's anorexic. I don't know why Apple Music does that, where, like, I'm trying to scroll and look at the lyrics, but it just forces me to go back down. You say she's anorexic, and you heard she likes when people say it. Think you already know her, but you don't. This one's for all my mean girls.
You say she's anorexic and you heard she likes when people say it. Think you already know it, but you don't. This one's for all my mean girls. This one's for all my bad girls. This one's for all my break your boyfriend's heart girls. For all my tearing shit apart girls.
Hell yeah.
This one's for all my mean girls. Yeah, it's
ooh, that was cool.
And she's out there with the razor sharp tongue stuck to skinny cigarettes, calls and daddy
razor sharp tongue
gold cross.
What? With a razor sharp tongue stuck to skinny cigarettes, calls him daddy while she's fingering a gold cross, and she's kind of fucked up, but she's still in vogue. It's a reference to an unnamed modern right-wing art movement in Dimes Square, New York, spearheaded by Catholic actress and podcaster Dasha Nekrasova? Dasha and other people associated with the Dimes Square art movement have made remarks that align with their alt-right beliefs, which many see as bigoted, problematic. Despite this, the movement has received significant attention in cultural press, and Dasha herself has landed roles in mainstream media such as Succession. Charli also reflects on the effects of stan culture, following an idol and listening to everything they do regardless of controversy. These lyrics broadly reflect one ethos of BRAT, being an it girl, being the just right amount of famous, self-referential, and knowing you're the shit.
And you hate the fact she's New York City's darling. You say she's problematic, and the way you say it's so fanatic. Think she already knows that you're obsessed.
Ooh, that was cool. I love when music just cuts. And this kind of piano part kind of reminds me of the Will and Grace theme song. I like this though. Sonically, this is a really fun song. I think it's actually a little more unique than a lot of the other songs on the album in terms of sound. Yeah, Yeah, biggest problem with the album so far is the amount of repetition. The crowd. Okay, I see how that ties in, like, the crowd being part of, like, the whole, like, the stan culture of it all sounds. Like, if all the voices on Twitter were a sound, it would be that, right? In terms of the sound of the song, I thought it was pretty unique. I liked it enough to put a mark to it. I like it enough to put a mark to it. I think one of the main issues I'm going to have with every track on this album is the extreme amount of repetition. For some people, that's a good thing. I personally love music when every single line is different. Places in this album where she does that. Like, it doesn't necessarily have to rhyme, it tells more of a story, but a lot of the album is repetitious. Okay, the next track on the album is going to be I Think About It All the Time. I'm finding that I'm liking the tracks that have kind of more specific names to them, like I Might Say Something Stupid, Sympathy Is a Knife, Girl So Confusing, like Everything Is Romantic. Like, these are kind of the tracks that speak to me a little more. So I hope this song is good. It's called I Think About It All the Time. Ooh.
I think about it all the time, but I might run out of time, but I finally met my baby.
Maybe this is crazy to say from like 5 seconds of listening to it, but it kind of reminds me of Tegan and Sarah, just a little bit.
But I finally met my baby, and a baby might be mine. Cause maybe one day I might, if I don't run out of time, would it give my life a new purpose? I was walking around in Stockholm, seriously thinking about my future for the first time. It was ice cold, playing demos on my iPhone. I went to my friend's place and I met their baby for the first time. How sublime, what a joy, oh my, oh my, standing there.
How sublime, what a joy, oh my, oh my. I don't know why that was so funny to me.
How sublime, what a joy, oh my, standing there. Same old clothes she wore before, holding her child, yeah. She's a radiant mother and he's a beautiful father. And now they both know these things that I don't. I think about it all the time. Think about it all the time. I think about it all the time.
That, I might that sounded cool.
Cause maybe one day I might.
I love that she keeps doing that sound.
Would it give my life a new purpose? Think about it all the time.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, that's cool. I like this part. No lyrics, just kind of vocaling a little bit.
So, we had a conversation on the way home. Should I stop my birth control? Because my career feels so small in the existential scheme of it all.
Whoa. Wait. Did she just say what I think she said? She just said, well, my career's, like, not important or whatever, so let's maybe have a baby. Cool? Okay. So, I think about it all the time that I might run out of time, but I finally met my baby, and a baby might be mine. Because maybe one day I might, if I don't run out of time, would it give my life a new purpose? Contemplating having children and her biological clock ticking. Seriously thinking about my future for the first time, it was ice cold playing demos on my iPhone. I went to my friend's place and then I met their baby for the first time. How sublime, what a joy, oh my, oh my. Yeah, same old clothes she wore before holding her child. She's a radiant mother and he's a beautiful father. And now they both know these things that I don't. So this is literally just a song about her thinking about, like, maybe I want a baby. Before it's out of the question, I think I might want that.
I think about it all the time.
The album's been very vulnerable in a hidden way. When you hear the sounds of the album, you're not thinking that the lyrical content is going to be as deep as it is, which is really interesting to me. Those songs always kind of throw me off because you're kind of like bopping, and then all of a sudden you're like reading the lyrics and you're like, oh, this like means something. Okay, so that was I Think About It All the Time. The last song on the standard version of Brat is called 365. I saw a tweet the other day that was like, I used to listen to 360 all the time until 365 came out. Now I can't go back to 360. So I'm wondering if they sound similar, if it's like a sequel to that song. We shall see. Bumping that. We're back on that. Oh yeah. It's like the same thing. That's cool.
Okay, here we go.
I like when a music artist does that.
When I'm in the club, yeah, I'm bumping that. When I'm at the house, yeah, I'm bumping that. 365 party girl. Should we do a little key? Should we have a little vibe? Wanna go real wild when I'm bumping that? Meet me in the bathroom if you're bumping that. 365 party girl. French manicure, wipe away the residue, push my hair back, look hot when I'm bumping that. No, I really don't stop when I'm bumping that. Gonna dump when it drops when I'm bumping that. Dial 999, it's a good time.
Ooh, dial 999. Wait a second, wasn't there a lyric in 360 where she said 666? And now this is like the opposite of that, 999. Or like, not the opposite, but like, you know what I mean. I'm a brat when I'm bumping that, she said the thing. Ooh, that was cool. Ooh, I like that. Should we do a little key? Should we have a little lime?
365 party girl. French manicure, wipe away the residue. Push my hair back, look hot when I'm bumping that. No, I really don't stop when I'm bumping that. Gonna jump when it drops when I'm bumping that. Down 999, it's a good time. Who the fuck are you? I'm a brat when I'm bumping that. Till the windows crack, I'll be bumping that. No, I'll never go home, don't sleep, don't eat. Just do it on repeat, keep. When I'm in the club, yeah, I'm 365 party girl. Should we do a little key? Should we have a little lime? When it go real wild when I'm...
It's kind of weird to come full circle like this after everything we just went through. Ooh, I just love the video game alien sounds, the very techno EDM kind of sounds. Like, you would hear this in like early 2000s. Trap remixes and EDM. Oh, I like it. Oh my god, this is reminding me of Zed a little bit. Oh, okay. So that was the standard version of Brat by Charli xcx. What a roller coaster. I cried, I danced, I laughed. I was a little annoyed at times. I think it was a good album. I think it hit all the things I was supposed to feel. I think it's really interesting to start the album with 360 and to end it with 365. They're both like the same song, but one is just a slight evolution of that. Where we start out in the beginning of the album kind of being a little nostalgic and longing for an older time, and also then going through her insecurities as an artist and her career.
I also just had a couple of thoughts, like, what if starting with 360 and ending with 365 is kind of like, okay, I'm that party girl, I'm in the club, that's what I do. And then all of the songs in between are sort of like the internal thoughts in between moments where she's supposed to perform as the party girl or whatever. So she's kind of putting on this like show the whole time, but these are like her struggles and her vulnerabilities. And it's sort of like everything that's going on behind the scenes that you don't see when she's in that persona. And then it ends with 365 to be like, okay, we're still here. Like, it's not a different place. It's the same exact place. It's just all these thoughts were there in the meantime. And sort of like, okay, let's resume doing what I always do, which is be the party girl and don't show everybody the vulnerable bullshit. That's just the thought I just had.
We do lead into a little bit more of the opposite side of that, I guess the bratty side. It really is. It seems like just like a bunch of diary entries and crazy thoughts. Thoughts you might chase around in circles in your mind. Surprisingly, this is a very personal album, and I related to a lot of it, and I didn't relate to a lot of it, and I think that's the awesome part about music like this is, relatable or not, you can still like bump that, and some things might be more relatable to others than certain things are to you. But with an album like this, ultimately it doesn't matter what's relatable or not relatable. If you just hit play at a party, It's going to sound good and you'll have a good time. But okay, that was my reaction to the standard version of Brat. I'm going to go to sleep now because it's 1 a.m. and I'm very tired. But I'm going to be reacting to the deluxe tracks tomorrow, and those will be available on Patreon probably a week before they end up going on YouTube. But okay, guys, if you like this video, be sure to give it a thumbs up and subscribe. Let me know what your thoughts and opinions are. Let me know when I miss something. I have a habit of, especially when I'm tired, not reading lyrics properly and also kind of giving up on trying to figure out a song that's going over my head. So I always welcome feedback. Just don't be rude if I interpreted something wrong. Like, these are just my interpretations of it. Sometimes I like music, sometimes I don't like music. You know, everybody has their own opinion, and I understand we all want to be the loudest one in the room, but sometimes you just gotta be okay with the fact that not everyone is gonna receive the music exactly the same as you, okay? Okay.
Oh, God. The emotional pain I just went through listening to this album. There's so many ups and downs and insecurities, and I really need to go to sleep now. Like, I need to sleep that one off. Bye!